Good morning. Welcome to the Commission of St. Mary's County meeting this date, Tuesday, November 10th, 2015. I am Randy Guy, President of the Commission of St. Mary's County, and I'd like to introduce the other commissioners joining me at the table. To my right, representing the First Commissioner District, which includes Ridge, Piney Point, St. George's Island, Mr. Tom Jarboe.
Good morning.
Seated next to him, representing the Second Commissioner District, which includes Leonardtown and Hollywood, Mr. Mike Hewitt.
Good morning.
To my left, John O'Connor, who represents the Third Commissioner District, which includes Charlotte Hall, Seventh District, and Golden Beach.
Morning.
And representing the Fourth Commissioner District, which includes Lexington Park, some of California, Great Mills, Mr. Todd Morgan. Seated next to Commissioner Morgan, at the end of the table, is Dr. Bridget, our County Administrator. On my immediate right is Sharon Ferris, our recorder for today, and Ms. Amy Carter, who you don't see, is behind the glass here, is our video media producer. So please turn off your cell phone, off or on vibrate. When you come to the microphone or representative's table, please approach by coming down the center aisle, and remember, this meeting is being televised. Look your best. So you need to speak clearly and directly into the microphone and recording purposes. This will be broadcast later. At 6:30 p.m. tonight, we will be holding a public hearing on Code Home Rule at the 7th District Volunteer Fire Department, 21660 Colton's Point Road in Avenue, Maryland. Next, we'll have our invocation by Commissioner Jarboe and pledge.
Please bow your heads. Dear wise and loving Father, first let me say thank you. On behalf of all who are gathered here today, thank you for your many and abundant blessings. Thank you for life itself, for the measure of health we need to fulfill our callings, for sustenance, and for friendship. Thank you for the ability to be involved in useful work and for the honor of bearing appropriate responsibilities. Thanks as well for the freedom to embrace you or the freedom to reject you. Thank you for loving us either way. From your boundless and gracious nature, in the scriptures you have said that citizens ought to obey the governing authorities since you have established those very authorities to promote peace and order and justice. Therefore, I pray for our commissioners, for our county staff and employees, and in particular for all assembled here at this meeting. I am asked that you would graciously grant them wisdom to govern amid the conflicting interests and issues of our times, a sense of the welfare and true needs of our people, a keen thirst for justice and rightness, confidence in what is good and fitting, the ability to work together in harmony even when there is honest disagreement, and personal peace in their lives and joy in their task. I pray for our agenda set before us today. Please give an assurance of what would please you and what would benefit those who live and work in and around our beloved county. It is in your most blessed name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Commissioner Jarboe. Okay, next we're going to go right into our...
Mr. President, I move to approve the minutes of November 3rd, 2015, as presented.
Second. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So moved. We're next going to go right into our public forum for Board of Education vacant seats. Dr. Bridget will call out the names of the candidates to come to the podium to speak. Each candidate will provide a brief overview of their qualifications with time for follow-on questions from commissioners. The schedule will allow for a total of 6 minutes. Let's get up, talk, sit down. Total for each candidate. So we appreciate you all being here. Thank you very much for applying for this very important position. Dr. Bridget, I'm turning it over to you.
Thank you, Commissioner President Guy. Our first candidate this morning is Elizabeth Long. Good morning.
Good morning. My name is Beth Long, and I thank you for this opportunity to speak to you today. I believe I'm highly and perhaps uniquely qualified for this Board of Education position. I have a wide range of experience as a professional, a stay-at-home mom of two children, and, as I'll describe later, a very active participant in the St. Mary's County public school system. After receiving my bachelor's in computer science, I spent 10 years working as a professional in the information technology field. I then spent 7 years in Europe while my husband was working in a physics lab in France and Switzerland. where I was exposed to the European early education system and gained an interesting perspective on the way they do things there. Since 2001, I have been a resident of St. Mary's County. My children have gone from kindergarten through high school in the public school system. As a parent, I have dealt with issues ranging from IEPs and the GIS program to 504s and AP classes. As all parents do, I have been there to see my children perform in music and in athletics. I have visited science fairs and book fairs. I have been a parent volunteer and coordinator for numerous school-related activities. However, I believe my main qualification is the fact that for the past 10 years, I have been a substitute teacher in our school system. I have earned the respect of those I work with, and teachers, principal, and even staff at Moakley have requested me for hard-to-fill positions. I have taken daily, weekly, and long-term assignments, including quite a few three-month positions, which include all the planning, grading, teaching, and many of the administrative functions that teachers perform. So I've gained a firsthand knowledge of what it's like to be in the trenches of our school system. I've taught everything from fifth grade math to AP English, and have worked everywhere from old trailers to newly renovated facilities, and even in the private schools such as St. Mary's Riken. I've worked with various staff, including teachers, administrators, special ed personnel, and lots of students. More recently, over the past 3 years, I have served as an adjunct professor at the College of Southern Maryland. I find these assignments challenging and rewarding, and I believe they have given me a remarkable insight into our school system. I believe when you agree to do something, you make a commitment and do everything in your power to do the best you can. The decisions before the board are difficult, and I recognize there are so many factors. I've seen quite a bit during my 6 years on the St. Mary's County Ethics Commission. I believe that fundamental values are important as acting as a compass and providing a direction. Education is especially important. I truly believe education is the greatest gift we can give this next generation, and I hope to be given the opportunity to support it as a member of the St. Mary's County Board of Education. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Long. Commissioners, are there questions for Mrs. Long?
Ms. Long, I have a question. You've had a varied opportunity with all these different types of substitutions, so you've seen the various different types of classroom settings, et cetera, and experience that. Do you have an opportunity for improvement that you'd like to offer to us that you've seen?
Improvement in myself or
For the school system as a whole? You've seen it from so many different aspects.
There are so many, a myriad of issues from the number of students that sit per classroom in our elementary schools to the way we administrate our APEX program, which is a program that is tailored for students who are really struggling, from identifying at-risk school children in the middle school before even they get to the high school or to Fairlead Academy, to preparing them from a basics of math and English, not only for university, but also just if they happen to go directly into the job market and for the career they've chosen, if this is their last education they will receive. So I see many things.
Thank you very much for sharing.
Sure.
Great, thank you, Mrs. Long.
I have a quick question.
Oh, sorry.
Ms. Long, can you name some of the key responsibilities of the Board of Education?
I would say first and foremost, budget, personnel, programs, looking to the future, five-year plans, facilities, which of course would go in line with the budget, coordinating with state mandates and state regulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Our next applicant is Mr. Jim Davis. Good morning.
Good morning, gentlemen, Dr. Bridget. With only 3 minutes, I thought I wouldn't recite from my resume, and I'd rather just share with you some of the important salient issues that I think differentiate myself from the other able candidates that you have seen so far. One is leadership. I have formal military training as a leader. I hold an MBA in finance from a respected school. Most importantly, I've been a successful entrepreneur. I've founded and started up 4 successful businesses. I've employed over 100 employees in my career. And all of the payrolls were made by me, not the banks. Back in the old days, you couldn't get loans on receivables. You had to use your own funds. So I have strong entrepreneurial experience. I'm a registered professional engineer. As a registered professional engineer, the state gives you not only the authority and responsibility, but they offer the trust that you have to give to make sure that there's public safety is ensured. I've been an assistant professor at College of Southern Maryland. I started up and built up a engineering construction management program. I'm a certified flight instructor, and in 5 decades, I've never lost a student, which I think is important. That's good feedback. I'm committed to education. As chief engineer for the General Services Administration at the DC Public Schools, I managed 32 renovations for the DC Public Schools. I've done volunteer work for public schools as a president of the Lexington Park Rotary Club, for example. We gave free dictionaries to all 3rd graders in the county. Superintendent Smith was a recipient of a $20,000 award that the Lexington Park Rotary Club issued to the schools. Community service, I think, is very, very important. And I've been a member of the Board of Elections. I've been chairman of the Airport Advisory Committee and was instrumental in working with Mr. Erickson and the new master plans for the expansion of the airport. I mentioned I was president of the Lexington Park Rotary. I was finance officer for the American Legion and director for the Leonardtown Lions Club. Now, most importantly, what I'd like to share with you is I know the members of the Board of Education, the 4 members. I have a lot of respect for them, and I think I can work closely with them. This job is only 1 vote. So what do? You have to provide leadership, and I believe you have to do whatever you can to compromise, if necessary, to get the work done. I'm fiscally conservative, but I'm a strong advocate of the children, and we need to do whatever we can to get teaching excellence. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. Commissioners, are there any questions for
Mr. Davis? There's only so many budget dollars available in a given year. We're seeing actually seems to be a flattening out of enrollment. What is your thought on budgeting for the Board of Education if enrollment is flat? Should it go up? Should it stay the same?
Very good question. I'm not sure I can give you the right answer. There's a $198 million budget this year, I think, proposed. About 54% of that budget, if I'm not mistaken, is in teacher salaries. There are certain sunk costs, if you will, that you have no control over. As an engineer, I have built, I've designed, I've built, and I've taught in schools. I know, for example, in capital improvements, we got a new high school we're talking about. I know the difference, for example, of the cubic feet of air per minute required for each student. I know the foot candle requirements. In other words, I know a lot of the esoteric data that's necessary. So when I look at a set of plans and an architect, and I love architects, it sounded like Trump. I love architects, but if you give them a free hand, they're going to do form, and function becomes secondary. So as a member of the Board of Elections, I would hold the architects under fire to make sure that they give us the best bang for the dollar in their designs. And if I might add, I work with Moshe Softy. I don't know, he's one of the world famous architects. designs these massive, beautiful buildings. He's sort of the Frank Lloyd Wright of today's world. He's never designed a building on budget. Most of his projects always come 30, 40, 50% over budget. And I happened to work with one project, which was the ATF headquarters. And that's what happened. It was 30 to 40% over. So I worked closely to try to value engineer to get the same value at less cost.
Any other questions, commissioners? Thank you, Mr. Davis. Next applicant is Lynn Duff.
Good morning.
Thank you for having me today. I have a little cold, sorry. My name is Lynn Duff, and let me start with telling you a little story about how I was introduced to St. Mary's County Education. I happened to work for the National Science Foundation National Research Council in Washington, D.C., and we were getting together with some of my friends who work for the National Science Foundation, and we were eating lunch and discussing an education panel that was going on at the National Academy of Sciences, and my one friend from the National Science Foundation said, "It is a known fact that if you have a child with special needs, go to St. Mary's County. That's where you want to live." And I never had heard of St. Mary's County at that time, so I thought, oh, okay. So a few years later, I married John Duff, who lived in St. Mary's County, and moved down here with him, and we had our daughter, Sarah Alice, and I became active in the education here. I was the chairperson for the food who helped build Project Playground, which is right behind the building here. I became active at Hollywood Elementary School, accruing 1,800 hours of volunteer service. I accrue those hours doing great books and LEAP and teaching in the classroom. LEAP was an educational program where we provided after-school classes for students six weeks out of the year. And we did everything from foreign language to boat building to airplanes and way beyond. I was able to increase it from 5 classes to 30. And also at this time when I worked at Hollywood Elementary as a volunteer, I worked on the Capital Improvement Committee for the school system. During Sarah's years in the elementary school, statistics came out that the county was going to have a drastic increase in children. At that time, Bob Bailey served on the BOE. And he negated that. He said, oh, it's not going to happen. Well, we saw what happened. We got an increase of students and didn't have the room for them. So that caused a group of us who are Episcopalian to try and start the Episcopal Day School. Well, that was a project that we undertook, and we organized to lay out the foundation for the school. I learned much about how schools run, what finances are needed, how to attract quality teachers and workers for the school, how to build a building, and so much more. But the most important I learned was how to work with others, which is very important for a common goal in education. It was a delicate a dance of offer and compromise, and it was ongoing. But alas, we couldn't build because we couldn't find a spot to build. Then I taught at Honey McCallum Christian Preschool, and I became the director of Little Seedlings Christian Preschool and Kindergarten in Leonardtown. As the director, I was invited to join the LAP at MSDE that was organized by MSDE and the Annie Casey Foundation. It's a tri-county group of people promoting every child will be ready for school. We call it here in St. Mary's County the Early Childhood Advisory Committee. And they glean their information not from just from MSDE, but from other states and countries and counties. When I left Little Seedlings, I became the director of CSM's Children's Learning Center, and I was privileged to be on the Charles County ECAC. Then I was able to see the difference in working with two different counties and what the needs are, even though we're a tri-county area. The ECAC has enabled me to continue my webbing into the communities and to find help and guidance for the little ones and their families. Between the Episcopal Day School and the ECAC, I've been able to work on obtaining grants to aid in funds for projects, but mostly to work as a team for a common goal. After leaving the CLC, I worked in the St. Mary's County Public School System as an early childhood IEP substitute, where I go in the classroom for the teacher who had to come out. And then I also became the sub, the next year I came as substitute instructional resource teacher for pre-K through three, grade three. And then last year I was a para in the kindergarten program, so I've kind of been weaving around. This year, though, I've taken a position as co-director of Little People's Daycare Center at Jarbo. And I also work still as a public school teacher.
Thank you, Ms. Steph.
Thank you.
Commissioners, do you have any questions for Ms. Steph?
What? Go ahead.
What do you, with the plethora of experiences you have, and you've watched the Board of Ed operate here, what do you think its biggest challenge is right now?
I think their biggest challenge right now is placing the money in the school system where it needs to go, and watching where that money, and trying to find out where we can obtain more grants to help the school.
Thank you.
Recently in the media, test scores were reported lower than anticipated.
In the PARC testing?
Correct.
Yes, sir.
What is your feeling on the PARC test, and how would you work as a team with the Board of Education and the teachers to improve those test scores if you support that type of testing?
I was in the school system last year when the PARC testing started in the elementary school. And the biggest challenge then, it wasn't that the children didn't know the answers, and it wasn't that the teachers hadn't been teaching it. It was the fact that the computer system failed. And it wasn't because the computers, that the computer people who work on the computers could do anything about it. The computers are old. They would shut down. They couldn't get their passwords in. They couldn't even get them up. You know, they'd go up for half an hour and then they'd close out. And it was so frustrating for the children that they just shut down. They just didn't want to do anything. So I think our biggest thing is the computer system.
Any other questions, commissioners? Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next applicant is Shannon Dyson. Good morning.
Hello, good morning, everyone.
Morning.
My name is Shannon Dyson, and so I feel like I have a unique perspective bringing to the Board of Education. I graduated with a bachelor's in visual communication design and a master's in publication design. I've been working in the field as a senior graphic designer for about 14 years. Specifically, my day job is working for an organization called FHI 360 in Washington, D.C., and we're a global nonprofit. And the types of work that I do there, I design facilitator materials, training materials. We design the actual textbooks for third and fourth graders for the country of Equatorial Guinea. I do the United Nations, the UNESCO GMR Education for All publication, which is a 300 plus publication that talks about education standards and milestones and where education stands at other places in the world, excuse me. Something that I'm working on right now, something specific, are training guides for a program called Peer Up, which is connecting people with diabetes. I think that, you know, my perspective working with, I work with focus groups and different organizations, both globally and domestically, to try to come up with the best way to disseminate information, to provide instruction. I was fortunate enough to spend 6 months with my family and my children, and my husband and I traveled to the Kingdom of Swaziland last year for 6 months, where we were able to connect with some of the local schools there. My children are very young, but my son, who was two at the time, was able to attend school in another country, which is very interesting to kind of compare how he's being treated and how he's being educated here versus another place. I'm an adjunct professor at Stevenson University right now, teaching graphic design to fourth year students. In addition, I volunteer for an organization called ICAF, which is the International Child Art Foundation. And basically, it's an organization that really tries to encourage empathy, creativity, and athletics in young people. And every 4 years, they gather children from all over the world to actually come to Washington, D.C., and they do different performances and things like that. So I'm very involved in that. My goal right now is to really kind of like focus my attention in how I use my energy for education and for children and adults and any kind of learner, actually, and to really focus on St. Mary's County. I've lived here for about 7 years. I'm not a native St. Mary's County person. My husband is. And, you know, we came here, I came here, and it's home. You know, that's why we came back here after Swaziland. And so that's pretty much it. I mean, I have a strong interest in learning. I feel like I myself am a lifetime learner. You know, I'm always interested in learning something new, learning something important, and sharing that information with others. I'm an enthusiastic learner, and I try to share that enthusiasm not only with my children but also with others.
Thank you, Ms. Dyson. Commissioners, do you have any questions?
Given your experience with the global education and training that you've been a part of and all the international groups that you've been a member of, what do you think you could pull? What salient points could you put away from your experiences either in Swaziland and looking at their education system or ICAF or any of these other international organizations that you think we would better in St. Mary's County by moving these type of ideas into our school system?
I want to say that not just because my children were in these programs doesn't necessarily mean they were the best. You know, they were just different learning experiences. But some of the stuff that I really felt that was engaging and just noticing, like, when my son was in school in Swaziland, there were different ages of children involved. And to see where the children were really most engaged was with, like, you know, like, experiencing stuff with each other. So, like, they were doing a lot of outdoor activities. There was a farm that they worked on and things like that, that they really were able to bring in these, like, more outside activities into the classroom and kind of keep the children engaged in a more active way.
So more experiential training than textbook.
Yes, kind of a combination of both, you know, like applying what you learn in experience into the classroom.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Can you tell me the key responsibilities of the Board of Education?
I believe they appoint the superintendent if necessary. They provide, they complete the budget, approve the budget. They apply different policies, and they search for different policies and add those to, you know, they adopt different policies from various places and pick the ones that work best for St. Mary's County and the students here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is Anita Getson present?
She's not here.
Okay. We'll move to the next candidate, Philip Holzbauer.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning, Dr. Bridget, and good morning, commissioners. My name is Philip Holzbauer. I'm absolutely astounded to be up here as a distinguished candidate for this position. What distinguishes me, among other people, is that, number one, I do have two children who went through the school system, kindergarten through 12th grade. They're both fine young adults today, thanks to their teachers. As a single parent, I found it very supportive. Okay, I retired in June of 2013 after 39 years of working as a regular education and special education teacher. I have several certifications, including one which would be really useful for a member of the school board, and that is I'm certified as a drug and alcohol counselor. That is a problem that we have that's coming down from DC. Okay. I want to say that if you were to walk into my classroom when I was teaching science or math, you would have found the kids working with each other. I believe cooperative education is the wave of the future. It was also the wave of the past. It needs to come back. Also, I was one of the first teachers in the county to use alternative testing. Paper and pencil testing, answering multiple choice questions doesn't work for everybody. In the packet, you'll find my rubric for alternate testing, and you'll notice that it's very tough, but it works well. Okay, I think that's enough about me. You'll see the lesson plan, you'll see that it's a very good and very complete. I want to use this forum to talk about our kids. Okay, because that's really what the school board's all about, supporting our superintendent so that he can support the schools and help the kids. Okay, if you look at a standard bell curve, you'll notice that about 15, and I'm rounding numbers here to make them easier, about 15% of our students are performing above average and into the exceptional range, and about 15% of our students have a hard time getting out of bed in the morning because the school offers them almost nothing. Okay, our above average students, most of them are going to college. They need to take AP exams. They want to take AP exams, but they're really limited by what we offer in the school district. Okay, they take a class to study for an AP exam, and then they take that exam. You may not be aware of this. They don't need to actually take classes in order to take AP exams. AP exams are separate from the school system. They just need to pass the test. I have a plan that I believe will enable our students to take as many as four times the AP exams within the same class period. If you look in the packet, you'll see that there's a listing there of what AP exams are offered at what schools. And you also notice that there are three columns after that which list places where students can go online and get free AP instruction. Okay, so they can go online, they can get instruction, they can actually download free AP study guides. They don't have to pay $20 for a Peterson guide or a Pearson guide or whatever. And that would help our brightest students. Our less able students, the ones who are right now clogging up our administration and causing problems for our teachers in the classroom, and I'm sure you all are aware that in 2014, the State Board of Education basically said, you can't suspend kids anymore. You can't expel kids. You have to try to work with them in the class. Only in the most dire circumstances can you take a child out of the classroom. When I was doing my administrative internship, I started a program. I ran it for 5 months, had the principals backing on it. I had the special education departments backing on it. I had parents backing and students backing on it. Kids had to volunteer for this program. It served kids who were absent for long periods of time and had fallen way behind. It also served kids who had behavioral problems. And this program that I set up for 5 months was so successful that only one student that went through it failed to go back into the regular classroom. I think that's important. Okay. I also want to say that we have a wonderful resource in the form of something called Performance Matters. Performance Matters is a data crunching program system that we pay in the county to belong to. They're in Florida. Okay, we have two wonderful staff members, Dr. Jeff Marr and Ms. Regina Greeley, who can do magic with that system. And this summer, well, actually this fall, I contacted Dr. Marr and I said, hey, can we do this? It would make life so much easier for the teachers. And he said, excellent idea, and he's going to look at it. And what if the county does what I'm suggesting, I predict, based on my, based on my 30 years roughly in the county, I predict it'll improve student performance and teacher performance by about 20%. Since teachers are being evaluated on how well their students are doing, a 20% improvement makes everybody happy. All right, and this, additionally, in terms of things that I did outside of teaching, I spent about 8 years working for SmartCo. That was the computer recycling group. Okay, I put computers, I rebuilt computers and laser printers, and we put those into schools, we put them into churches, put them everywhere. I also put them in my fellow teachers' classrooms when we were still using Apple computers.
Thank you, Mr. Holzbauer. Commissioners, do you have any questions?
Mr. Holzbauer, you concentrated your early discussion on the bottom 15 and the top 15% of kids.
Yes, sir.
What do we do with the 70% in the middle?
Well, here's the thing. If the idea that I have for the top percentage works, then we will be able to save about 30 to 40% of our AP time in terms of staff hours. Those teachers can then go back into working with the middle. If we take that bottom 15% that costs every teacher 15, 20 minutes out of their class period every single day, then we give the teachers back basically a whole day of teaching during the week. Okay, I mean, when I was a classroom teacher, if I had a child, and actually usually it was a teacher would come to me and say, please help me get this kid out of my classroom. I don't know why they didn't argue with me when I said come. But if we can give the teachers back that 60 minutes a week or so, that makes their teaching more effective for the vast majority of students.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You mentioned the lower 15% behavioral issues. What's your feeling on school resource officers or law enforcement officers in schools and how they should apply it into the classroom handling disciplinary matters?
Okay, that's an excellent question. And I assume that you're referring to the incident that was on the news recently where the officer took the kid out of the seat.
No, there's multiple incidents okay. Now. But
well, the first thing is that I think if a child is acting out in class, the first responsibility is to get the other kids out of that classroom, okay? The school resource officer should be there to support the administration. It should be administration that's dealing with that, not the school resource officer. Okay, he's there to back them up.
Any other questions, commissioners? Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
The next applicant is Christopher Crush. Good morning.
Morning, sir. My name is Chris Crush. I retired in 2003 after 33 years in the classroom. I taught for 3 years at Omaha Technical High School in Omaha, Nebraska, and 30 years at Thomas Stone High School in Waldorf, Maryland. I have a lot of experience in the education of our children. A few years ago, I started thinking, well, now that I've retired, maybe I should put some of this experience to some sort of use rather than just waste it while I'm still lucid and ambulatory. I'll go brain dead here because I didn't bring any notes. What I'm bringing to the Board of Education, I think, is experience over the 33 years. I would be able to make decisions based on my experience. I would be able to say, yes, this is a good idea, and here are the reasons why it's a good idea, or no, this isn't a good idea, and here are the reasons why. Maybe we should try this idea, and here are the reasons why. Maybe we should or we shouldn't spend money in this area, and here are the reasons why. I'm a fiscal conservative, and that's pretty much my pitch, my experience in education over 33 years.
Thank you, Mr. Presch. Commissioners, are there any questions?
How much experience have you had with the St. Mary's County Board of Education?
I had 3 children who went through the public school system. Oakville Elementary and Leonardtown Middle, Choptagon High School. I have a daughter who's teaching at Choptagon High School right now, son-in-law who's a vice principal there. When my children were in school, I was president of the Athletic Boosters Club. Even after I retired from coaching at Thomas Stone High School, I was asked by the head coach at Choptagon High School to cover for him one Christmas season while his wife was having a baby. That's pretty much it, I guess.
Sounds like a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
The next applicant is DeForest Rathbone. Good morning.
No. Good morning.
Morning.
I'm DeForest Rathbone, and my resume tells you about my experience with on governing boards and also with industrial engineering or industrial education. But my particular strength right now is as a member of the National Parents Anti-Drug Movement. And so let me give you a little background here on why that's so important to the drug and alcohol issue is so important to improving the success of the schools. I went to Great Mills High School during World War II when my father had moved the family to St. Mary's County to work on the original construction of the base. I now look back on that as the most pleasant year of my life. Great Mills High School was run by Miss Jane Mattingly and Miss Martha Mattingly, who provided us with a safe and friendly school environment where there were no drugs, no fights, no disrespect of teachers, no bullying, and virtually everyone learned and graduated on time. In those days, teachers could turn a kid's pockets inside out to see if he had a slingshot, firecracker, or a frog that could disrupt the school. That search was fully authorized under the prevailing legal doctrine of in loco parentis. That's the concept where the teachers had the full authority of the parents when the kids were in their custody. And schools were safe places for kids and teachers. And that prevailed for the next 20 years. However, in 1969, the Supreme Court's Tinker decision suddenly revoked the rights of teachers to act on behalf of the parents in disciplining students, and instead gave students access to the full federal judiciary to oppose local school disciplinary incidents. And in the vacuum produced by that decision, drugs, alcohol, tobacco, and violence flooded schools everywhere in America, not just St. Mary's County, everywhere. and parents and educators were blindsided by the unintended consequences of that misguided Supreme Court ruling. Another devastating ruling in 1960 seriously endangered school children. State legislators reduced the drinking age to 18. As legally drinking teens then shared their newfound pleasure with their younger friends, a bloodbath was created on the highways from soaring teen drunk driving fatalities. Those dangers all came to a head in the early 1970s when violent school riots broke out in many schools across America, including my own school in Northern Virginia. An official school inquiry revealed that drug and alcohol use and sales were prevalent in it throughout the school and contributed to the dangerous disorder. When we parents became aware that this had become a nationwide problem, we came together as Nancy Reagan's National Federation of Parents Drug Prevention Movement. Then, armed with this new information and a collaborative partnership with us parents, educators adopted new drug prevention policies that resulted in reducing student drug use by over 50% throughout the 1980s. To combat the teen drinking age disaster, parents went directly to Nancy Reagan, who informed the president, who then led Congress to enact a federal mandate in 1984 to return the drinking age to 21. That mandate has reduced teen drunk driving fatalities by 70% since it was enacted. Today, we parents are collaborating with St. Mary's County School Administration and Health Department in efforts to improve health-based drug prevention strategies to better protect St. Mary's children. I believe that my appointment to the school board could help enhance that collaboration. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rathbone. Commissioners, do you have any questions?
I'm curious about execution, what you just said. How would your health-based practices for anti-drug, how would you introduce that in through your position as a school board?
It's already been introduced, sir. The health department, and in fact, you guys put $100,000, we came to you and said we got a problem, and you said, okay, here's $100,000. Of that $100,000, the health department arranged to educate the school counselors on a thing called SBRIT, screening and brief intervention and referral for treatment. It's a screening program where when they identify a kid that looks like he's in a little bit of trouble, they bring him in, they counsel him, they screen him, and give him some immediate counseling. And so that's already in the process. Now the question is, how widespread should we take it, and can we improve that particular process? But that's one of the things that we can do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Part of the implementation, as I'm sure you're aware, the funding for that program was cut this year and been allocated to other locations of that $100,000, such as criminal offenders outpatient treatment. So the funding for that program is not there. In your efforts to go ahead and do this, how would you go ahead and try and allocate the funding also from within the Board of Education budget? And beyond this narrow focus, how would you work to better the school system in a broader spectrum?
To answer the broader section, a board simply, in most cases, in the boards I've been on, reacts to what the administration is bringing to them. They have the initiatives and they discuss it and then you ask them questions about it. So I didn't remember the first part of your question.
How would you implement this seeing how the funding isn't still going to that program from
this board? Yeah, thank you. We parents went to Congress about this school drug thing a long time ago. Congress passed some laws called the Safe and Drug-Free Schools Act. And in that, they put a bunch of money to the communities. So this community has a ton of safe and drug-free schools money, and it's a matter of just reallocating some of that to the things that they think might help the best. So it's not a matter of the local budget being cut a little bit. Besides, that's not a very expensive thing. The screening is not a very expensive thing. You got the problem. You're going to have somebody dealing with it anyway. This is just a tactic for identifying the problem and fixing it.
Thank you, Mr. Rathbone.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Next applicant is Timothy Wilson. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you.
Good morning.
My name's Tim Wilson. It's wonderful to be here to sit and see the face of each one of you. I read about you in the paper. I'm new to the area. I do not have the experiences that you all have. It is wonderful sitting in the audience and resting assured that you all may be able to participate to help shape and guide the policies of the district. I've been here about 7 months. In truth, about 3 weeks, because I've been in the military. I've traveled all around the world, so my perspective, my unique thing that I could give or provide would be a unique outlook. I have a lack of paradigm shift to have knowledge about every subject that you're talking about. But I do have a wealth of experiences with my time abroad and my 2 or 3 times as an instructor or teacher in the military. So I was enlisted before, and I learned under Admiral Rickover, which is not a very good way to learn. And then I taught at Naval Nuclear Power School. Following that, my only other time period of learning or being a teacher was as a flight instructor. I was a pilot training officer at the Fleet Replacement Squadron in Norfolk, Virginia, and to teach people under a lot of stress, or what they perceive as a lot of stress, is very interesting. So as we sit here, I don't know all the questions that or the answers to all the questions. I found out that probably policy, budget, and planning is probably the 3 things that I would say what a school board should do. They should shape the opinion, possibly, and stay within the rules and guidances. Now, we have to be careful, and the reason I'm here is a little bit of not an anger, but a frustration. I have worked with programs where instead of $100,000 is not the money that matters. You can give me $1 billion. It is the quality assurance of the feedback loop. Did we get what we paid for? Is this what we set out as a priority? And did we meet the objective? If the answer is no, why don't we have a meeting and decide what the objective should be? So the 4 people on the board, I also learned that there are 4 people on the board. That would be something that they could provide the region and the commissioner for adherence to policy and carrying out the duties. With that, I think that's it.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Commissioners, any questions?
How do you define leadership?
Leadership, great question. That is the art of achieving the objective, possibly without you jumping in and doing it yourself. Feeling the art of leadership, so as you as an individual or a team member in that group feel motivated to achieve that objective. It is not the leader that needs to lead the team always. It is a success if each member of the team suddenly becomes the leader. In the 4-person board or in this region, if each parent, each child feels motivated about showing up to school on time, doing well on their tests, and continuing, that would be the leadership of education in this region.
Thank you.
Good.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Next applicant is Carol Wolgemuth. Good morning.
Good morning. I have applied for this position because I think it is absolutely essential that the Board of Education include the views and perspective of an educator. For 39 years, I taught school here in St. Mary's County, and I would provide an incredible amount of institutional knowledge, as well as a sense of how board actions and decisions impact schools and classrooms, how they affect teaching and learning. Although I spent my entire career as an intermediate grade teacher, my experience is not limited to that classroom. I spent several years coordinating summer school, K-5 summer school programs at various sites, and in that capacity, I managed and lived within budgets. I worked with transportation, food services, and multiple staffs to coordinate the program. I also spent several years teaching U.S. history to 11th graders in summer school and got a real powerful sense of awareness of the differences between elementary and secondary learners and school culture. I also had the opportunity to serve on numerous educational policy and program committees and commissions, not just here in St. Mary's County, but also at the state and national level. When I retired in 2010, I went to work for St. Mary's College as a supervisor, and for the past 5 years, I have worked with student teacher interns and their mentor teachers in all three of our high schools, three of our four middle schools, and eight different elementary schools. I do the same thing for Western Governors University, which is an online teacher education program, and I have supervised students, not just here in St. Mary's County, but also in Charles and Calvert County. I think these experiences have allowed me to stay connected to the current trends, initiatives, programs, policies, and school climate and culture here in the county. One of the joys of retirement has been finding time to volunteer, and I have participated in a real wide collection. I teach students and adults at Otterley Plantation. I sort books for the library. I decorate Christmas trees for hospice and usher at Three Notch Theater. But I found most rewarding are the social outreach programs, both through my church and other community organizations and agencies. I see regularly the terrible impact of poverty, addiction, homelessness on children and families. Now, from the time I was a kid, my parents preached the value of an education, and I still powerfully believe that that is the best path to success and contentment as an adult. That being said, I know that no matter how noble their intentions, no matter how lofty their goals, the school system is a business, and its leaders must consistently employ good business practices. To me, that means accountability to all students. You know, effective management of resources, openness and honesty in all actions, decisions, and communication. I thank you for the opportunity to introduce myself here. I hope it is apparent that I value excellence in education, diversity, inclusion, and that I hold integrity and trust, respect in high regard. I know that my skills, experience, and knowledge would enable me to provide leadership and build a vision of our schools that all can share in. Thank you,
Ms. Wohlgemuth. How are you? Thank you. Commissioners, any questions?
Can you name three of your strengths and three of your weaknesses?
I think three of my strengths. I'm a great, great organizer. I make lists. I check things off. I have timelines. I also am a real consensus builder. I know I've been part of many organizations where with conflicting opinions that I think I do a good job of the art of compromise. I also think that the ability to relate to people who are very different than I am. I think over my years of connecting with families and parents we didn't have shared experiences, but I found good ways to connect. Now you want my weaknesses too? I think they're more personal than professional. I tend to sometimes, I don't want to say get too emotionally involved, but I sometimes think with my heart instead with my head would be one of them. I didn't anticipate that question. I would say when I hear the resumes of other people, my entire experience has been education, and for some, I do not have a lot of experience in the business community, so maybe that would be one, but not that I'm all that, but I can't think of another one off the top of my head.
It's a very tough question. Thank you very much.
It's very good.
Thank you.
And commissioners, on your agenda this morning, it does call for a break for you to reconvene at 11:45 for county administrator time. So if you so desire, you have a 20-minute break.
Okay, we do not recess until 10:45. Is that correct?
11:45.
I'm sorry, 11:45.
Thank you.
11:45.
Thank you. That clock.